What are promises and why use them? JavaScript has a problem. It's single-threaded. What do we mean by that? If something takes time, the JS engine can't do anything else in the meanwhile. Occasionally, when I'm coding a while block, I forget to increment the variable in the end condition. This creates an infinite loop. When I do this, everything freezes. The browser doesn't respond anymore. I have to force the window to close. Now, obviously, this is an extreme case. But let's step back a little. Movies run at 24 frames per second, and video games at 60 frames per second or more. 24 frames per second mean one frame every 40 milliseconds or so. To produce a fluid experience, any process in JavaScript must get the job done within 40 milliseconds or less. Otherwise, users get the impression that the application is lagging. If you want to call an API on a web server, the message's round trip is bound to take longer than that. But the browser can't afford to wait. So we need to find ways to tell the code to do other stuff while it's waiting. The first solution is to tell the browser, run this process or call this API, for example. And when it's done, let me know. More precisely, on completion, execute this function that I've provided as a parameter in a function call. This function we want the code to call back is what's called a callback. This callback function allows us to add further logic in reaction to the server's response. For example, when the user clicks on the button, first log in by calling the login API, and when the server responds, retrieve additional authentication data and interpret it. Then call a web server with the login data to update the player's information. In this example alone, there are three callbacks in play. The first one responds to the button press, the second manages the call and response to the login API, and the last one retrieves the response from the second web service. Bear in mind that this example is neither particularly far-fetched nor complex. But this kind of process produces callbacks within callbacks within callbacks. The code quickly becomes unreadable. It produces what we can call callback hell. Another problem arises with this kind of operation: error handling. Imagine you have a specific processing to carry out at each stage or depth of the callback stack. Imagine now that an error occurs. If it's not managed with a try-catch, the error message is useless. That's without even touching on the cases when the code fails silently. The only solution is to add try-catch management at every depth on every callback call. This quickly becomes unwieldy. To try to solve these problems, a new kind of object was invented. It has three fundamental properties. It encapsulates asynchronous processing. It can be chained without the need to nest callback functions, and it handles errors. This object is the promise. It has two functions that can be called on it, then and catch. The then function takes the result of the resolution of the promise as a parameter and then returns a new promise. The catch function takes the error as a parameter and also returns a new promise. The fact that these functions return promises is precisely what allows us to change them. That is to say, to do p.then function 1 dot then function 2, where p is a promise. Chaining allows us to read code sequentially instead of diving deeper and deeper and deeper into nested callback functions. And promises trigger the first catch regardless of which step throws an error. This allows centralized and sane error management. Now, how can you create a promise? Let's code a function that creates a promise that waits for a specific time. Let's call that function sleep. The promises constructor takes a function. This function takes two more functions as parameters. These are typically called resolve and reject. We call these when the process ends. Either it succeeds, in which case we call resolve, or it fails and we call reject. So we're creating the promise here within constructor, and this function returns set timeout resolve with the number of milliseconds. The second parameter, reject, is not used here. We could forget it and not use it, but we'll keep it just to be complete. Now, if you do sleep 100, then console log done, we've produced a promise that triggers a function after a certain time. Promises are good, but we can do better. I've got good news. There's an even better way to call promises. It might feel different since the then function is never explicitly called. Instead, this syntax relies on the async await keywords. But all it does is allow us to call promises. How does it work? Well, let's take an example of a basic promise sequence using our sleep promise. We do const wait equals brackets, fat arrow, open the brackets, sleep 100, then sleep 100, then console log 2 seconds later. Using the async await notation, we can write the same thing as const wait equals async brackets, fat arrow, curly brackets, await sleep 1000, await sleep 1000 again, console log, and we're now 2 seconds later. There's only a difference in syntax here though. The same promise objects are being called. If we wrap the two await calls in a try-catch, it'll handle errors just like synchronous code does. All this transforms the way of writing promises, and it closely resembles how we write synchronous code, even if in fact we're calling promises. The wait function defined above also returns a promise. So in summary, JavaScript is all about interacting with interfaces and APIs. Callbacks used to be the preferred way of doing this, but they have many drawbacks. Promises are a far better solution, and the async await syntax uses promises to describe asynchronous behavior while staying readable and close to what we know as synchronous code. And above all, it allows us to escape callback hell. And if you want to learn more about JavaScript syntax, I suggest this video here.